Good evening. It is 7 o'clock. Welcome to this evening's meeting. It is July 21st, 2014. We are going to go into a public hearing. I'd like to call this meeting to order. I need a motion to go into this. Councillor Martin, Councillor James, all those in favor? It's unanimous. This evening I have with me my council colleagues, Councillor Jack Arnold, Councillor Rosemary Wallace, Councillor Gail Martin, Councillor Terry James, Councillor Dave Hall. I'm Acting Mayor Ted Schaefer. With me this evening is Darren Light, our Director of Corporate Services, Paula Cusack, our Deputy Corporate Officer, Francis Chung, our CAO. We have our Director of Development Services and Economic Development, Roy Beddo, Director of Engineering, Rick Baumhoff, Rory Thompson, our Fire Chief, and Kim Hilton, Director of Recreation, Culture, and Community Services. So I have quite a motion here, and the motion is to resume the public hearing from July 7, 2014. And this public hearing, it's quite lengthy. I have to do this for the legalities of it all. This public hearing is resumed from the public hearing that was adjourned on July 7, 2014. The purpose of the adjournment was to allow council to attain further information about the development. The public hearing is reconvened pursuant to Section 890 of the Local Government Act in order to consider the following proposals. Bylaw 2936, Zoning Amendment and Development Permit Number 2-14. The purpose is to amend the Zoning Bylaw 1996, Number 2100, and add a new comprehensive development zone, CD37, and to rezone the properties located at 19690, 19700, 19710, 19720, 55A Avenue 2, new zone, in order to accommodate 28 townhouse units. Development permit number DP02-14, applicable to the subject property, will also be considered to address building form and character. The applicant is Fred Adab Architects. At the public hearing, the public will be allowed to make representation to council and all persons present who believe that their interest in property is affected by the proposed bylaws and development permits shall be given a reasonable opportunity to be heard or to present written submissions respecting matters contained in the proposal. Those of you who wish to speak concerning the proposed bylaw and or development permit, commence your comments to council by clearly stating your name and address. Then you may give us your benefit of your views concerning the proposal. Members of council may, if they wish, ask questions of you following your presentation. However, the main function of council members this evening is to listen to the views of the public. It is not the function of council at the public hearing to debate the merits of the proposed bylaw or development permit with individual citizens. Everyone shall be given a reasonable opportunity to be heard at this meeting. No one will be or should feel discouraged or prevented from making his or her views heard. However, and this is the however, as some of you have had an opportunity to speak to the proposal at the July 7th session of this public hearing, I would ask that if you choose to speak again, that your concerns relate to the new information only. Any person who wishes to present a written submission to council may do so. All those submissions will be retained by the corporate officer and copies of submissions will be available from her on request following the hearing. Bylaw number 2936, Zoning Amendment and Development Permit number 02-14, a proposal to rezone the properties located at 19690, 19700, 19710, 19720, 55A Avenue, in order to accommodate 28 townhouse units. To the corporate officer, has there been some correspondence received?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I will just tell you that this public hearing was advertised in the July 15th and 17th issues of the Langley Times, as well as a notice was placed on the City Hall notice board on July 8th. We received...
Can't hear you.
Oh, sorry. Can you hear me now? One letter of correspondence was received in support of the development, one letter was received in opposition of the development, and one letter was received expressing concerns about the effect of the development on an existing complex.
Thank you. Now, Mr. Fred Adab, would you introduce and present your project, please?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, ladies and gentlemen. I'm the architect of the project. I'm here with Mr. Ron Hong, civil engineer, and Mr. Yan Voss, which is traffic consultant. So I briefly, very short and brief and fast, go through the project again. I assume everybody is familiar with it from the past public hearing. And then after me, Ron speaks about the construction of the lane and what we discussed with the city in a meeting we had. And Jan will explain the traffic study result. Our site is a 1.03 acre flat. We are proposing 28 three-story townhouses, 14 two-bedroom, 14 three-bedroom. And the sizes of these townhouses, they are ranging from 1180 to 1,450. This photo shows the surrounding development. Photo to the left, this one shows the existing lane with the marquee development, which has been they paved the lane up to that point. And so the issue is this portion of the lane to be asphalted and to be built as per city of Langley specification. And this is the marquee development, which is right to the east. This is the streetscape of 55A. This is a site plan, and the site plan are four building blocks. The entry is from 55A pedestrian entry. The vehicular entry is from the lane, right and left, and all the units are tandem parking, double car garages. We have visitors parking on ends of the property, east property line, west property line, four visitors parking there. And we have landscaping in the courtyard. We have landscaping along 55A. All the units along 55A have direct access to the pedestrian, direct access to 55A. And the units at the back, they come through this walkway, and they access from the front door here. This rendering shows the two building blocks along 55A. This one shows the facade of the block 3 and 4, which are the in the courtyard. And the materials are brick at the base and combination of hardy siding, vinyl siding, asphalt roof. And the railings are black, and the trims with the vertical bay windows that we have are white. This rendering, this the top one shows the side elevation, and this rendering shows the marquee and this development along together. These are the floor plans. As I said, there are two and three bedroom, and main floor is garages, and upper floors are living, dining, kitchen, and upper one is bedrooms. And these are different floor plans, elevations, landscaping, and this is the civil study for the lane. I only want to mention an item that everybody was aware of, and that's under the OCP we can go for 4-story above 6 foot of underground parking. For this site, that will result in 72 units, because 70 units per acre is the density, and this site is 1.03 acre. So it results in 72 units and 119 parking, including visitors. What we are proposing is 28 units and 62 parkings, including visitors. In terms of timing, the question came up last time. If this project is approved tonight, we assume that we will get our development permit in about 2 months, and we assume that we will. It will take our office about 4 months to submit for building permit drawings, and Everybody knows City of Langley is one of the fastest municipalities in processing the BP and DP application. So I assume probably 3 months or so. So from today up to digging the ground is we are about 9, 10, 11 months. So I give the opportunity to Ron to explain the lane, and then to Jan to explain the traffic study.
Good evening, Mayor and Councilors and staff. What I'd like to explain is a few concerns that was raised over the last council meeting with regarding the lane and the retaining wall that's south of the lane. The existing lane is not paved. It's a dirt road, and the retaining wall to the south of the lane, which is the Hunter's Field Green property, is a wood tie retaining wall. What we are proposing to address the concerns with regarding to drainage and also the integrity of the existing wall is a few items. One, the new lane will be paved, and the drainage will be directed towards the center of the lane, and it will be drained away from a underground storm sewer. This will direct the water away from the property to the south. Secondly, the existing retaining wall will be replaced with a new concrete retaining wall. This retaining wall also forms part of the the curb of the lane. So essentially, the if you look at the lower left corner of the slide, that will be the curb and the retaining wall in one integral unit. That's okay.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Go back. Maybe you point to the right slide.
Okay.
This one right here. Okay, so this slide here. Thank you. So this concrete block here, it forms the curb as well as the retaining wall to the property to the south. This will, along with the paving of the lane, address both the drainage concerns and the retaining wall issues that were raised during the last council meeting. What we are also proposing to do is, because the existing fence is in good condition, we're planning to basically disassemble the retaining wall and reassemble the wall, the fence, I'm sorry, on top of the new curb. This will actually raise the height of the fence slightly, providing a little bit more visual separation. Yes. The top left view is a taller retaining wall. This retaining wall is right now a concept. It doesn't apply to this development. This will be one of the options that we'll be looking at for the future development to the west of the site. One other option we're also looking at is to have speed humps in the lane to further reduce the speed which the cars may be traveling in the lane as well. That's pretty much it for my presentation. I think we'll now introduce Jan Voss. Yeah, he's our traffic consultant.
Good evening, Your Worship, members of council, ladies and gentlemen. Can I have it, please? Thank you. My name is Jan Voss. I'm a professional traffic engineer with the firm CTS. By way of introduction, I've been a consulting engineer for over 25 years. I've personally conducted over 200 traffic impact studies to date, and this just happens to be one of my areas of expertise. We were hired last week specifically to answer a couple of questions that were raised at the previous public hearing. The first one was regards to how much traffic would this development generate on the laneway. And what I can tell you is that for 28 townhouses or multifamily units, as we often call them, the peak volume they would generate is 15 vehicles during the busiest hour of the week. That is the weekday afternoon. It's a combination of when people are coming home from work, when people perhaps are going out shopping or to recreational activities. To put that in perspective, 15 cars an hour, what that means is about one car moving about every 4 minutes. So in theory, I know this sounds a bit silly, but you could lie across the driveway of this particular proposed development for about 3.5 minutes before you actually have to get up and move out of the way for that. So there will be an increase in traffic for the laneway. There's no disputing that. But I just want to put the volume into context that it's the maximum volume forecast is 15. A couple things I want to mention on that. Most municipalities, and as well as the province, they have a series of warrants or thresholds for when a formal traffic impact study is required. And I'm bringing up in this context because I want you to understand the volume of traffic that's being proposed here. Both the provincial government and most municipalities, they use 100 or more new vehicle trips as the trigger. This particular development is 1/6 of that. It would take 6 of these developments, sorry, 6 times 28 units, before you got to a level of development that would generate enough traffic to warrant someone like myself to look at some of the intersection impacts. And so it's important to keep that in context. Neighboring municipalities, City of Surrey, they actually have a threshold of 150 or more new vehicle trips. So the development would have to be 10 times the size. And these new volumes, they could either be 100 in or 100 out or 50 in or 50 out. It doesn't matter. It's just the total net volume. And you know, from that point of view, I just want to mention that from a professional traffic engineering point of view, what's being proposed here really is quite negligible. It will be hard for me to measure the impacts on the adjacent roads just because of the daily variations in traffic volumes anyways. My final comment was there was a request made with regards to the potential for the lane capacity and at what point would there be the need for a new laneway connection over to 55A. I did a site visit this afternoon, and by my estimate, the lane can probably handle about 100 vehicles an hour, which is about one car every 2 minutes. So you have one car going one direction for 30 seconds and then another car going in the other direction. The site right now generates 15, so you would need a few more of these developments before you actually start having a capacity problem. I would argue that what you'll probably have triggered beforehand is a need for a secondary access for emergency vehicles, so that should there be, you know, kids playing hockey in the laneway or a car stopped or someone loading or unloading, that there would be the need for a secondary access to the rear of the laneway to access that. So that would likely trigger your warrant for a second access to that lane. So I'd be happy to answer any further questions later on. Thank you.
Thank you. Have you finished, Mr. Adab, then?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And I would like to invite the public in attendance who deem that interest in their property affected by the proposed bylaw and permit their comments. So first person up, please give your name and address.
John Fuller, number 9, Huntsville Green, Mayor and Council, and I'd like to thank you, first of all, for listening the last time we were here, because I see some major changes in the attitude and the approach to all the properties in the 55A area. I fully subscribe to what the developer is doing. I like the idea of the buildings. We like it. The only so there have been some very positive things happening since the last meeting, and I've just had a early talk with the architect here. Our basic concern was sight lines for the new development into our existing structures. And if you look at, I'm going to take this out, please. If you look at the left-hand section there, where the retaining wall will be built to hold the road, the bottom one, thank you. What we're asking is if it's possible to put that concrete structure a little higher, which from the lane's point of view will help towards any water or any egress or whatever, would also help for structural strength for any vehicles down there that might, for any reason, go towards the fence, backing up, that type of thing. Would also give us a possible higher sight line, or non-sight line, I should say, for the complex. And we are very pleased. I'm very pleased. Dave Thomas, my partner, is very pleased with the whole manner in which you dealt with it last time, and it's been dealt with. I read basically everything here and gone through everything, and I understand exactly where the city's coming from. I understand where the developer's coming from, and this is the only thing that the two of us would like to see is a slightly higher, maybe, you know, a foot higher, the concrete. And then on top of that would go our existing wall that they would take down. The existing fence. So I thank you for all of the work that's been done, and thank Francis Chung, especially for making sure that we all were looking at it in a more careful way. We really do believe that in the future, further down, albeit said what this gentleman has said about traffic, It is a laneway which provides emergency access in many ways, but there probably should be further down an access from 55A as you go west into the properties. I also understand from reading, if you've read the papers, that it's been recommended that the two complexes, the one that's under review tonight and the one that's been completed, they have been designed such that there will be an internal flow. I also understand that the developer of the first property is seeking to perhaps buy those two at the end on 198th to put them through so that there will be less of an amount going through. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Is there further comments from the gallery? I have asked our corporate officer to read out something.
Is there a Miss C. Sharp? Oh. Are you okay? Looking for C. Sharp?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. How about H. Green?
Hi there. Again, I was just wondering what the other gentleman said. I was wondering what you mentioned before about another access for the other buildings that will be coming further down, which will be off 53A. Was that correct? 55A. Yeah. So he is also saying that there should be access from the other side of the buildings.
Okay.
The engineer, okay. We would have liked it, of course, on this one. Doesn't look as if we're going to get it, but we would like to have that. As mentioned before, too, about the height of the extra concrete.
Right.
You know, if we went 2 feet up, that would be the same to put our fence back on. Because that would give us, especially from the second floor, where they're going to have the patios down looking on to us, okay, that would be a great help too. So, you know, it's as far as I was asking that there was no lights, that, you know, when you go to park the car, the lights automatically come on, then that would also be shining from up straight into our place, so we wouldn't like that. Privacy, you know, the lights, the noise, and privacy for the townhomes. The secondary access, of course, we wanted anyway. So was there something else anybody would like to say? So that's really what I was after, okay. Just an extra couple of feet.
Thank you very much for your comments. To our corporate officer, do you have another name?
The last name on the list is H. Green.
Hello, my name's Heather Green. I live at 58-19649 53rd Avenue in the Huntsville Green. And I left last meeting pretty upset about the whole effect of, I'm one of the properties at the back, lane access on the other side of the fence. And I guess one thing that we didn't talk about is our lifestyle as seniors, and that when we bought our townhouse, we haven't had the opportunity to live there very long, less than a year. And we bought into not just a townhouse, but a 55-plus lifestyle. And this is why I think that we deserve a quiet neighborhood that's safe and secure, because we already chose that when we bought into Huntsville Green with the gated community. And we have a lot more leisure time as seniors, and we are out on our back patios a lot, and I think that this noise factor will really affect me. So I just wanted to speak on how I feel affected by about the noise and the privacy on the against the back fence there. And my question about green space is that there appears to be so little green, there appears to be landscaping, but what about just plain green space for children and pets to go out on to? There doesn't seem to be any in the proposed development. And there's also a clump of trees at the southwest corner of this lot, and I'm just wondering if they fall in, or the size that fall under the tree protection bylaw 2830. And if they don't, will they be replaced? Thank you.
Mr. Adab, do you have any further comments on their comments?
No, I don't have further comments, so I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Do you like to make any clarification or anything with the comments that they have?
Before the meeting, I talked to my client, the developer, and he has no problem of John's suggestion having a foot higher retaining walls. The only thing that would result is that the fence will come at a level, goes up along this property by about a foot and comes back again as being existing. So we have no problem with it.
Okay. So is there comments? Councillor Martin and Councillor Hall.
So, Mr. Adab, you just said that if you put the wall another foot higher as requested,
yes,
the fence is going to go along.
Yes.
There, the fence that you're going to rebuild, then it's going to go up.
Yes.
It's going to go along.
Yes.
Come down and then go back again.
Correct.
So are the residents aware of that?
Yes. Yes. Can I answer that, please? As a resident? Yes, we are, because we know that there are future developments and they are happening very, very quickly, and that the expectation hopefully would be the same continuing down. So it would always be the same if they were completely developed all the way to the 196.
Thank you. Councillor Hall?
A few things to clarify. Let's stick with the fence issue to start with. When we first received this, we were told that there was, I'm better this way. Okay.
When we first encountered this proposal, there was a suggestion that there was a grade difference from east to west, and I'm getting different information. So if we were to build that new retaining wall that high at this end, does that mean that at the far western end, some people were talking about a difference of many feet. So would that mean that at that far end, rather than an addition of 1 foot of cement, at that far end, would we be talking something like 3 feet?
Mr. Adab, would you answer that one?
Correct.
Through the mayor, to the developer.
Correct. As the retaining wall goes toward west, the 1 foot becomes 2 feet, 3 feet, 4 feet. So from Hotsfield Green looking to the north, you will be looking at a concrete retaining wall and a fence on top of that.
Can I?
To Mr. Adab.
Okay, I'm sorry. Just a minute. Supplementary to that. So in discussing the situation with some of the residents that live at the western end, they have an existing fence next to 196 that is huge. And their objection to this suggestion was that then they would be enclosed with a massive wall, not just on one side, but on the other side as well.
Can I speak?
There are some.
Can I speak for the Huntsville Green?
No, you may not, because I have the mic. Thank you. In a bit, you
if
can.
If you want to sit down, Mr. Adabo. Yes.
So is there a way to achieve a gradient that does not have the people at the far end with a massive wall that they might object to come to a compromise between the expressed needs of these people that have delegated, but also the needs of the people further down the lane in a future scenario? That's one set of questions, then I have others.
Ask the developer to answer that.
Yes, Ron.
Currently, the retaining wall, there is already a retaining wall on the west side of the property. It's a landscape wood-tie retaining wall. I believe it's around 6 feet high. So, and this retaining wall is not in good shape. So I imagine the developments to the west, which will be in the future, will be replacing that retaining wall. Now, a concrete type of retaining wall would be the most structurally sound. So, and they will probably be doing something similar, is to disassemble the existing vinyl fence and reassemble it back. So you'll be looking at, yes, a retaining wall, but it's a more structurally sound retaining wall with the white fence on top.
Councillor Hall?
That partially answers. I guess what I'm saying is, if we start at one end and we know that eventually at the far end on the west end we're going to have a higher gradient, the higher we start to the east, will that affect the height at the furthest extension at the west?
The developer, if could you answer that, please? Yeah. Mr.
The answer could be yes or no. Right now, the development to the west is not happening yet. When it happens, we can look at the grade of the lane. We can perhaps grade the lane down, similar to what we are doing on the east side right now. We're actually grading the lane down slightly, and with the addition of the top of the wall, which is by raising the curb itself. So on the west side, we can grade the lane down, which reduces the height of the retaining wall. So that may happen. It depends on what the future development plans out.
Councillor Hall, did you have a supplement to that?
Well, I guess the question then becomes of staff. So looking at future development, would we be looking to require a grading down of the lane? Or would we envision maintaining the consistency of the lane and having that retaining wall grow in magnitude further down the road?
Mr. Chung?
Your Worship, to Councillor Hall, I think, like the consultant said, we'll probably be looking based on the future development of the site. We may do either increasing the height of the wall or do a combination of both, lowering the lane and minimizing the height of the wall to balance it off between the development, current development onto the west and to the east. So there could be a combination. I can't answer definitively the answer at this point, but we're going to try to look for the best solution.
Mr. Chung, a question for myself is that we're assuming that the future development to the west would be townhouses, but there is the opportunity is there for an apartment, is there not? Four-story or five-story apartments along there?
Your Worship, that's correct. That's within the OCP plan. The developers, whoever buys that, could come in and develop a multifamily development. Then they can do that, yes.
Thank you. I'll let you go to the mic once more.
Thank you. This issue is not really an issue. And I explain this clearly, that the land has a contour difference. Not only does it go like this towards the west, but it also goes like this from 55A to the bottom. So therefore, there would not be any difference. It would be a contiguous wall that, as it is at the present time, as it goes along by the lane, it goes, dips down, and follows the contour and has that 5-6 foot fence at the present time. So no, we're not asking for that proposal to have a massive intake, but it is all to do with the contour of the land, and that's the situation we're in. So that really should explain that there is, from our point of view, there is no thought for having, you know, massive change towards the end. This is just to create that sight line. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Hall.
Okay, next one to clarify. The suggestion by the traffic consultant was to have a second access. So as we progress, I guess the question through the mayor of staff is that is there currently underway some present negotiation for a right-of-way in the presently existing developments that have not necessarily been acquired to allow that kind of secondary access?
Mr. Chung?
Your Worship, Council Hall, that's something that we're contemplating on. We will be looking either a hammerhead or a secondary access to 55A. In terms of where that's going to be, staff will be reviewing that, and so we'll be informing future developers once any new applications come through.
Thank you.
Okay, two more. There was some mention of a tree protection bylaw, and I'd like some clarification of that. I believe that we tried to pass a tree protection bylaw, but that did not pass it. So perhaps the reference to that bylaw is a township bylaw?
Mr. Chung?
Your Worship, the Council Hall, that may be a draft bylaw that was contemplated by Council at one point in time. As you said it, we don't have a tree preservation bylaw. It was brought to Council a few times, but it didn't go through.
So we have a landscape design, and I'm not sure exactly what trees are being spoken of. So could we go to the picture of the landscape design and suggest where these trees might be? I might ask the person that raised the issue, could you refer to the map, please?
Yes, sir. Never saw that. On your side would be southwest corner.
Okay, and so the trees that are on the lane, those are existing trees? They're not new plants?
Yes. No, they are new plants.
These are all new plants?
Yes.
So where would the existing tree be?
The existing trees, we haven't shown them, and I think it should, we haven't considered that as being preserved. There are islands that you see between the driveways, and those are the new trees.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr.
I was just wondering about the diameters, because I did read that tree protection, and I assumed it was a policy. So, okay.
No. Is there further questions of council?
One more.
Oh.
Last one. All right, now, I want, through the mayor to staff, to have Mr. Beto explain the difference between what's currently designated in the zoning as single family, but under the official community plan designates this as multi-family. What public input has there been into the official community plan, and how has this generated a rezoning application?
Mr. Beto?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, through you to Councillor Hall. Many of the properties on 55A Avenue are currently zoned single-family residential, RS1 zoning. However, they are designated in the city's official community plan medium-density multifamily residential, meaning they have potential for up to 70 units per acre development. In our conventional RM2 zone, that would be a four-story apartment type would be the maximum density possible there. The official community plan, the current one, was adopted in 2006 with extensive public consultation. Even going back before that date, the previous two OCPs as well designated this area for multifamily development. So that pattern, that designation generally has been in place for some time.
Thank you. Further questions? Seeing none, I need a motion to close the public hearing. Councillor Martin.
Could I speak, please?
Is it pertinent to this? Is it at last minute?
Yeah, what you were just talking about on the... what you just brought up about the what could be put on the next lot could be apartment buildings. What the heck, we were talking about the traffic of single family. Now if we're going to have those, then you've got to dig under and do the car park.
Well, we're not talking about that down the road. That'll be a further discussion. And right now, under the public hearing.
Okay, it's
under
nothing
the public
to do
hearing,
now.
It's just this project right now.
Right, you are then.
Okay, Councillor Martin moved it, seconded by Councillor Arnold to close. All those in favor of closing public hearing? All those, it's unanimous. Next one is a motion that council will resolve into committee of the whole. I need a motion for that. Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Wallace. All those in favor, it's unanimous to go into committee of the whole. The development permit number 05-14 Jaguar Land Rover Automotive Dealership at 5978 Collection Drive. And Christopher Boyzak couldn't make it tonight, so Kevin Walsh is here this evening. And he's accompanied by, Mo is here. Hello. Mr. Beto, have you set it up for Mr. Walsh? Welcome, Mr. Walsh.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and members of the council and other staff members. This is a Jaguar Land Rover showroom for Collection Drive and Glover Road. It is part of a overall development of car dealerships in this area. It's similar to the other developments. It is a high-end car dealership, and the design reflects that. It is consists of two buildings on site, totaling just over 3,000 square meters. There is the Jaguar Land Rover building just on the lower portion, on the southwestern portion of the site, and a luxury car showroom on the northeastern portion of the site. Just on the right-hand side of the page there, or your left-hand side, is the existing Porsche showroom. This is just a blow-up of the floor plans. Just has the super luxury showroom, which is just a pavilion. I will get into some more detail about that at a later point. And this is the Jaguar showroom and shop and associated sales areas, different sales areas and maintenance areas on the bottom portion of that sheet. We have done some shadow studies, but as it is a building there is no other buildings in very close proximity, so the shadow studies aren't really an issue, I don't feel. This is just a floor plan. It consists of the Jaguar showrooms, Land Rover showrooms, and it has a shop area where people can maintain their cars and a used car area here. The Jaguar design of the Jaguar showroom, it was done to reflect the Jaguar Land Rover brand, and it's based on their own international set of rules. All the Jaguar Land Rover showrooms that are being constructed at the moment follow the same principles but are adapted to the different sites. As such, they have similar materials and similar architectural expression. They are designed to be very transparent and for ease of customer use. The elevations of the building, they're high quality materials. There's different shades of silver metallic alucobond. There's planar glazing, and there is a profiled metal cladding to the lesser important parts of the building. Buildings, again, are designed so that they have maximum visual impact for the people who are using them, i.e. that they're very transparent, very clear. This is in addition to this, as part of this application, we are requesting to modify the current pylon signs to have additional signage on them. This is because from the original time these signs were approved and constructed, the overall uses on the site have changed somewhat from what was anticipated, that there are different, increased number of different brands of cars for sale on this site, and that it is required we have additional signage for them. It is preferable, we feel, to modify the current signage, pylon signage, rather than ask for additional pylon signs on the site. These signs are sited at the north end of the site and the south end of the site, and indicated in these little circles here. In total, there is 37 square meters of additional signage being asked for. The other building on the site is what we call the super luxury pavilion. This is for high-end used vehicles that may be traded in when someone buys a new Jaguar or Land Rover car. It's conceived as just a pavilion in the lines of some historic examples like the Glass House by Philip Johnson in Connecticut and the Barcelona Pavilion in Barcelona of 1929. These are very simple rectangular buildings that reveal themselves as you approach to them, and they're treated very simply with a glass facade and again a dark and a lighter metallic alucobond finish for the solid parts of the building. It is just a single space, as you can see in a preliminary layout, that the cars would be informally arranged in that. And like the other Jaguar buildings on site, it is designed so that it is quite transparent, although in this case there is some more solid wall, as opposed to being on the corners of this building. The solid wall is in the centers of the elevations, as you can see here. So the solid parts of the elevation are in the middle, and the corners are broken and visible with structural glazing. You may notice a blank facade here. That is so that the building will reveal itself as you come around the corner on Collection Drive, and it's to add the suspense and the occasion of purchasing your car here. The landscaping on the site is kept quite simple. All trees are to be clipped so that you can have a clear vision from underneath them, that they will not, for security purposes, it will increase visibility on the site. There is to be no high landscaping per se for this project. Again, just shows some further detail of the landscaping in this site. Mo, would you like to say anything?
No, I think Kieran mentioned it all. And
grab the mic.
Yeah. Hello, Mr. Mayor, and everyone. Hopefully, everybody's having a good summer. I think Kieran mentioned it all, and it's pretty straightforward. I'm basically here also talk about the pylon signs. When we purchased the land from Anthem Development, we've thought about this for quite some time, and we realized the best way to approach this, and they're all luxury brands, so the best way to approach this is to have use the existing pylon signs as kind of gateways to the, as well-known gateways to the city of Langley and to this development. It's pretty well, it's a landmark that's recognized by it. Pretty straightforward, I think.
Thank you. Now, are there questions from anybody in the viewing audience on this particular project? Out in the gallery. We have one gentleman. Name and address. Year of birth. Children. Height, weight.
Hi. I'm Rudy Storteboom. I live at 276 at 20180 Fraser Highway. And I'm going to be turning 60 this year. I just wanted to know about the height of the sign. It was a concern the last time it came up. Is it going to remain the same height?
Yes, it is exactly the same height.
Thank you very much.
Welcome to the 60 Club. Councillor Hall.
I raised this and I had my questions satisfactorily answered at APC, but I ask it in a public forum.
Yes, sir.
We're having both a variance on signage and a development permit on form and character of the structure. And I'm just wondering why we would have both of those items mixed together. I have no objection to the sign. Actually, as I said, my questions have been addressed, but in some future development that's looking for a variance on signage, if it's tied into the whole thing, I could object to the signage and it could jeopardize the whole development. So I guess through the mayor to staff, I'm asking why we are dealing with both of these items together, and whether there's potential when we go to the business part of the meeting to divide these with any problems to the development permit application.
To staff.
Mr. Mayor, this has been more a function of the timing of the application coming forward. In other words, we're dealing with an application for a new dealership with two new brands. And the new brands are what's, pressing the developer to request additional sign area. So it was just convenient in that respect to deal with it at the same time as this DP coming forward. And there is, of course, the potential to vary a bylaw provision under a development permit, and that's what the applicant is making use of in this application, this combined application.
Supplementary.
Councillor Hall.
At this meeting, I don't want to delay this going forward. At this meeting, Is there opportunity to simply divide this permit application into the signage variance and the rest? Or would that necessitate them having to come back on a separate sign variance application?
To staff?
Mr. Mayor, it is possible to split the recommendation, I guess, into two components and have council consider two resolutions, two separate resolutions, one for the DP, for the dealership itself, and a separate resolution on the sign variance.
Mr. Chung?
Your Worship, I'm not quite sure, but I think with the DP, you could separate it out because we did go through the advertising of the notice to the residents about the DP, but a variance, I don't believe that we require that to advertise, so I guess we could separate out between the DP and the variance permits to separate motion, if so choose by council.
Thank you, Mr. Chung.
Okay, so that would take a motion. So when we get to the business part, I will make that motion, look for a seconder. It's at council's will whether we do that. If that's not the will of council, then we deal with these both together.
Perfect.
It's coming forward.
Thank you, Councillor Hall. Further questions?
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to mention, just to answer Mr. Hall's question, when we did the BMW, the first initial development, the BMW Mini dealership, through the development permit, we also submitted, I can't recall, you know, it's been a while, a variance also for the BMW tower sign. And so it's nothing different, I mean, it's fine, but nothing different than what we're doing here. Yeah, and then also I think we submitted another variance for the pylon signs, I think.
Yeah. Councillor Hall?
So if my memory serves, at the time I objected to the not this sign, mm-hmm. but rather the other one that sits on top of the BMW dealership, and potentially that could have jeopardized the whole development if I'd swayed everybody against the sign. So all I'm saying on a cautionary note, while I'm going to support the sign variance, if some other developer comes to me at a later date and they try to tie signage in with their development, there's a potential risk there. So I don't want to really set that precedent. If the precedent was set that it was tied together, I don't think that that's a practice that we should be continuing.
Councillor James.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Well, while it's been mentioned, just for the sheer sake of clarification, in the event that the motion as it stands later on in the meeting were to fail because we were combining the two, could we not then, at that moment, could somebody not pass a secondary motion to split the two at that time if it failed? Or no? It would have to be done like... Okay.
If you have a motion on the floor and it fails, you can't bring it back. Well, the mayor can bring it back under reconsideration.
Correct.
Or two
okay.
council members on the prevailing
Great.
Side.
Thank you.
Further questions of the developer? Seeing none, I need a motion for that Committee of the Whole rise and report. Thank you, Councillor Wallace, Councillor Arnold. All those in favor? It's unanimous 4. Thank you. And to Canada's first luxury auto mall, you guys can have a seat. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Adoption
Thank
of
you.
The agenda. I need a motion that the agenda for July 21st, 2014 regular meeting of council be adopted and as amended is by removing the Kwantlen First Nation from the community spotlight section. Councillor Martin, Councillor Arnold. All those in favor? It's unanimous. The minutes of the public hearing held on July 7th, 2014 be adopted as circulated. I need a motion for that. Councillor Hall, Councillor Wallace, all those in favor? It's unanimous. The motion that the minutes of the regular meeting held on July 7th, 2014 be adopted as circulated. Councillor James, Councillor Wallace, all those in favour? It's unanimous. And business arising from the Committee of the Whole. Bylaw 2936, Zoning Amendment Bylaw for 19690, 19700, 10 and 2055 A Avenue, a motion. Third reading of bylaw cited as zoning bylaw 1996, number 2100, amendment number 121, 2014, number 2936. I need this motion. Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Hall. Is there a discussion? Councillor Hall.
I want to say some positive things about the proposed development. I don't want to mess things up because I think we've arrived at a point where there's a pretty good compromise situation. For this particular area, I think it addresses a need, and to the credit of the developer and the architects, they've designed something that is a niche in the community that we need. We need some housing that's available in the way of town houses. I think this is preferable to the potential that there was for four-story. I'm convinced at this point that people can work out the issues concerning the lane. I'm pleased that we delayed this, not to inconvenience the developer, but rather that I personally had an opportunity to go and stand on the second floor of the marquee, see what the sight lines were like, look at the existing fence, look at the condition of the lane, talk to some people in the area, and I have not only comfort, but I have great satisfaction that this is a tremendous asset to the community. And as we develop that area, as was raised as a concern, I believe that there have to be community amenities that come along with this. There's money set aside to perhaps upgrade Bryden Park. And so while the developments aren't necessarily expected to provide community amenities within these townhouse complexes, certainly there's an obligation that the city take some of this development money and deliver it towards an upgrade for all of the apartment blocks and townhouses that are in the area. Thank you.
Further discussion? My own comments are that I think this is a positive for the community there. The area is in transition, and like my colleague, I walked down the grass right away that's back there, and I'm surprised my colleague never brought back some of the blackberries and apples that were there. So, and again, looking in the marquee, that's a very nice complex going on the second floor myself. It's going to be a very nice development, I think. I think the developer is should be commended for the work that they're doing there. And it takes money to put these developments together, so to the developer, he has listened. The council has listened. We put this on hold for a couple of weeks to get some new info, and it's going in a positive direction, I believe. So I need a vote now. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. Now, the next item is development permit number 0514, Jaguar Land Rover Automotive Dealership. A motion that development permit application DP05-14 to accommodate a 3,091 square meter Jaguar Land Rover Luxury Automotive Dealership at 5978 Collection Drive be approved, inclusive of the variance to modify the two existing freestanding pylon signs by adding an initial 37 square meters of signage area to accommodate the new luxury dealerships. We need a motion. So. Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Wallace. Councillor Hall.
I'd like to move to split the motion.
There's a motion to split it. Councillor Arnold seconds it. On the motion to split, discussion. All those in favor? Against? Councillor Martin was against splitting. So is two motions then, please?
The signage to be dealt with first?
It's the other way around, but the dealership?
I would like to deal with the signage first, but it's up to you.
to the...
I just want to clarify. So we have a motion that the development permit application 0514 to accommodate the Jaguar Land Rover
right.
dealership be approved.
That's
period.
On the floor by Councillor Martin, Councillor Wallace.
I'll withdraw the motion.
Right now we have a carried motion to split them into two, so I just want to confirm that I have the two motions.
I need a vote then to have
first
the
I just want to confirm that that's the first motion, that the DP be approved, and that the second motion is that a variance to modify the existing pylon signs, et cetera, the signage area to accommodate.
So if my colleague...
It's fine. With the motion to amend to have two separate motions, we have those two separate motions on the floor.
Right.
And we can go from there.
Okay.
And deal with one at a time.
So the first one we'll deal with is the development permit itself, right. application DP05-14.
That's right.
So
we need a mover and a seconder for that.
Mover was Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Wallace. Okay, discussion on that one. No discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Second item is the signage that Councillor Hall and Councillor Arnold put on the table.
And that would be a motion to modify the two existing freestanding pylon signs by adding an additional 37 meters squared of signage area.
Right. Okay, so that motion is on the table separately, so there's discussion on that.
And sorry, I need a mover and a seconder.
Okay, Councillor Hall,
okay.
Councillor Arnold.
Thank you.
Okay, all those in favor of, because we separated it already.
Yeah, so we can have a separate.
Now we can have the discussion.
Yep.
Councillor Hall.
Okay, if you'll recall when we went back to the original dealership sign and the variance, I didn't like the idea that it had this great prominence. Other people decided that that was the case. I didn't think prestigious auto dealerships needed that kind of presence because their product would speak for themselves. But that having been said, the other day at the APC meeting, I asked the question, what would be the alternative if we didn't pass this and put a few extra plates on the existing sign at the existing height? What would be the alternative? And the proponent suggested that, well, I guess each individual dealership could have their own sign positioned all around the site. So I'm convinced in this particular case that this is the best option. So I'm with them on this, and I'm happy enough to, if not propose it or second it, at least speak to it. So my only concern was setting a precedent for the future. I don't want these sign things tied in, because I think you have to have a strong argument, like the proponents have, for a single sign of prominence, rather than something that's got, you know, it's like, what do they call that, a Burma shave or something, where you have this sign, this sign, this sign, this sign, and it starts to look like the self-raiser way in Abbotsford. Goodness, we wouldn't want that, would we? This is Langley City. Thank you.
Councillor James.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Wow, roundabout way. I just wanted to say that I agree with Councillor Hall. I think this is probably one of the classiest signs that we have in that area, definitely, if not the community. Its prominence speaks volumes, and I personally can't wait until every single one of those slots is filled.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the signage? Against? It's unanimous 4. So I'm assuming Councillor Hall will be picking out his Jaguar there. Thank you, gentlemen. So the motion has been carried.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So community spotlights are Kwantlen. Thank you. Our Kwantlen First Nation couldn't make it tonight. They were going to make a presentation. They had a death and at their nation and could not make it. So under the mayor's report, our next regular council meeting is September 15, 2014, and that's televised. Our regular council meeting 29, 2014. There's nothing on Metro Vancouver. Library happenings. Councillor James.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Well, there's always things happening in our library. So from the top, between July 22nd and August 31st, these are the four things going on in our library that they wanted to highlight. So the first one is the ongoing Lego Fun at the library, which is the fourth Monday of every month. The next one, it goes from May to August 25th from 4 to 5:30. They'd appreciate registration. And basically, the library has the Lego and the kids bring the ideas. So this is drop in and bring your dream creation to the library. The second, they've expanded on the Lego Fun and its popularity with Lego Racer. And on Saturday, July 26th, so this Saturday from 2 to 4 o'clock, they're asking kids ages 5 and up to come build a Lego car and get ready to race. Kids are going to work in pairs, build their motorized cars with Lego and have amazing races. And they'd appreciate a phone call in advance, and I'll share that number at the end. Second Story Theater on Tuesday, July 29th from 2 to 2:45. They would appreciate some registration, and this is an opportunity for audiences to decide the fate of the improv actors as they play games and tell stories for 45 minutes. It's like a choose-your-own-adventure book that's unfolding right before everyone's eyes, and they have asked that it's suitable for kids 6+. And last but not least, and something new, is Uzami Teiko, which is Tuesday, I hope I said that right, Tuesday, August 26th from 2 to 2:45, and again, they'd appreciate registration. They'd like you to come experience the heart-stopping pulse of Japanese taiko drums combined with beautiful flute and storytelling. We have an award-winning, world-famous Uzumi Taiko group, and they're going to take you on an awesome journey. So for this and more information going on in our library, they're asking you to please call 604-514-2850, and that's what's going on. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor James. I've got a couple of items here. The first one is by the Focus Media Group, and they put out a publication to the business industry. It has 30,000 issues that go out. And to the viewing audience, it is called Metro Vancouver's Best Kept Secret. And put simply, the city of Langley is one of the best kept secrets of Metro Vancouver. The British Columbia city enjoys close proximity to Vancouver as well as a rich history, a strong sense of community, and all the amenities of a major urban center. So if you check out your computer on the website, and it is the Business in Focus magazine, and I actually have a bit of a smile from Councillor Hall on this one here. So it is, I'm very pleased that this city is working in a positive direction, and it takes staff a lot of time to make us all look good. And this particular one is showcasing the awards that the city of Langley has won, and the six of us are standing very proud with our awards. So again, check it out. The next item I have is the Aldergrove Fair Days. I'd just like to thank my council colleagues from the neighboring municipality for inviting me, and for Karen Long, Bobby Long's wife, who put a lot of time and effort into that. And I thought I did the city, my council colleagues, quite well in the quick straw category. I got number 2. So I would bet I was beat out by a country western singer, and I've never done this before. So it was a lot of fun, Aldergrove Fair Days. I'm plugging my community. You did an excellent job there, and it was great. So I didn't get the gold, but I got silver, so I was pretty happy with that. Now, the next item I have is Bylaw 2942, Election and Assent Voting Procedure Bylaw. A motion that final reading of a bylaw cited as Election and Assent Voting Procedure Bylaw 2014, number 2942. I need a motion on this. Councillor Martin, Councillor James, all those in favor? It's unanimous 4. Committee reports. Parks and Recreation Advisory Committee, Community Gardens. And I have three motions here, and I'll ask Councillor Hall to speak to the report, and then we can do the motions.
Staff have been working on a report on community gardens. The thinking was that the existing ones should be expanded. There should be other locales where some might be attempted. They brought some information to the most recent Parks and Environment Advisory Committee meeting. At that meeting, the members of that committee looked at a number of different proposals. They narrowed it down to four locations, and they've come up with these recommendations, thinking that if people with an eye onto these parks were to have a commitment to them, they would both have a presence at the park, but perhaps would embrace them more. So they were looking for some kind of a process, I would assume led by our city staff, to have people embrace these parks, provide some input, and then a choice later would be made on the basis of the commitment of the community. So with that in mind, I would move these recommendations, striking the words in number one that the Parks and Environment Advisory Committee recommend that, and replacing that with Langley City Council will, and then consider the following parks to locate in new community gardens: Michaud Park, Douglas Park, Linwood Park, and Dumais Park. And two, that a public consultation meeting take place to assess interest in the proposed locations from area residents. And three, that community groups or area residents be approached to create a group that will organize, maintain, and operate the community garden on a day-to-day basis. Perhaps staff want to wordsmith my change in the wording at the top to standardize it in some way.
Our corporate officer has that. Do you want to do that all one motion? I have no problem, one motion, unless there's a, is there a seconder for the motion? Councillor Wallace, discussion? Councillor Martin?
Thank you. Through to staff, can I assume at this time there are no budget implications on this, given that there's none in the report?
That's correct. We have a capital budget to complete a project of this nature. Yes.
Okay. I guess I would appreciate, you know, what kind of cost implications we're looking at here, if even if it's in the budget. Almost every report always has budget implications. So that's fine. Thank you.
And we would bring back a report when it comes to making a decision on the location about, and we would investigate the cost. Depending on where it is, and there might be different costs. So we didn't do an estimate on each of these four yet.
Thank you. Councillor Arnold and Councillor James.
Thank you. Councillor Hall said that what we're looking for is to get opinions from people that, I guess, overlook these areas, was, I think, sort of the word he used. And I can't help but wonder if we're going to ask people the parks that they are near and the parks that they look out over, if we're going to ask them what should be done with it, but we're only giving them one choice. We're saying community gardens. If we're going to ask the public their opinion, shouldn't they have other choices? Dog off leash, leave it exactly as it is, put a playground in there, or I mean, if we're going to ask them what we think should be done with the park in their neighborhood, they should have more than just one choice.
Councillor James, then Councillor Wallace.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just so I'm clear on this, I know we have had discussions on another community garden, and I don't disagree with the, you know, kind of determining a location that would work best. I don't necessarily agree with all these locations, but I know that when staff comes back with their report that the recommendations or the preferences will become clear, I'm assuming. But can I guess, can I ask Councillor Hall, or maybe through you, Mr. Mayor, who the appropriate party would be, if there's an outreach to the community, to a group in the community that will organize, maintain, and operate, and there is no take-up, is that it? Because then it will have serious budget implications to the end run, because if there's no community group that's willing to take this on, it's a huge operating cost to our existing staff, and something that I don't know, that's never really been part of the discussion. So I just want to clarify that if the outreach is made and there is no uptake, then am I safe to assume that the report will come back and then parts two and three will be considered based on each independent action?
Mr. Chung.
Your Worship, to Councillor James, yes, we will consider all that and bring back a report to Council with based on the consultation in terms of the preferred location, the cost implications, and whether there's going to be a group going to be taken up to manage and operate this. So if one falls off the side, then we'll also obviously we'll bring it back to Council for consideration.
Councillor Wallace.
I just want to speak to this and the importance of growing food. It's an upcoming thing that I believe all municipalities should be engaging in. And as far as the take-up, I'm under the understanding that a community group, so these parks were chosen, so I'm thinking, looking more at the neighborhood taking responsibility, a group in a neighborhood taking responsibility for the garden plots. For instance, I look at Linden Park and I see a lot of families using that park recently. So I think, you know, you'd probably present that to a neighborhood. I don't know how you would do that, though. I don't know how we would go about presenting that vision to a neighborhood so they could take it up. So I'm just, I have a question for Councillor Hall in, this is a committee gathering of wanting to do this and these parts that have come forward. Can you just give a little bit of a background of, you know, I mean, is this just a little bit more? Thank you.
Background. Well, in the last capital budget, based upon the recommendation of the consultant we had on the master culture and recreation and parks and whatever else was supposed to be in that hodgepodge. The last capital budget approved both a dog off leash park and expansion of the community garden. So that's the genesis of this, and the committee has worked back and forth with staff on a number of potentials. We've had lots of discussion. Staff actually were the ones that came forward and said, you know what, rather than having a citywide application process where we have a waiting list and we go down this waiting list and those people have moved along and it's difficult to get the commitment, rather, maybe my choice of overlooking the site is not a good one. In the close vicinity of the site, perhaps people would embrace this. We had other discussions. The idea that perhaps a couple of plots could be reserved in some way to produce food that could be distributed through either one of the faith groups or through the food bank or something like that. And some organization out there might embrace that idea as a charitable exercise as well. But one can't know that until one actually gets out and consults with the public to see what's there. So going forward, the budget is actually there. I guess if there's staff costs within the budget, that might erode from the building of the plots and the servicing of the plots if we're assigning staff consultation time to that. But I think that that was a pretty generous capital allocation. And perhaps we need not go the full bore and go with 32 additional plots. We have 16 right now. Maybe the answer will come back that maybe two of these locations might better accommodate 12 each or something. That's yet to be determined. That's what public consultation is all about.
Councillor Wallace?
So just to follow up, so in consultating with the public, and we find out that they very much want to take part in the growing of food, could we not, if there wasn't a budget for staff to, let's just say, build the plots and stuff like that, go to a community organization or business that might want to contribute in that? Is that a possibility through to staff?
Mr. Baumhoff?
I mean, that is a possibility. It depends on the questions we ask in the consultation process. You know, one of them will be, you know, who is interested in assisting, overseeing the community gardens? Another would be, you know, is there interest in helping develop the gardens themselves? You know, it is a bit difficult as a government. You know, people don't necessarily come in and say, I want to help the government to build something. It's more if there's a volunteer group, maybe LEPS.
Yeah, so
you know,
LEPS
managed it, you know, maybe there's a way that we can get more community involvement in it. So this whole process is a bit of an investigation.
That's what I was thinking with the LEPS organization, taking that on, them being the ones that request the materials. So they're taking on the initiative. I know LEPS, for instance, is doing a program, I believe, this week in showing the community about growing food. So I just, think that we can look outside the box, because I think that we're at a time where it is important to be growing food.
And they do oversee a couple of gardens in the township as well.
Yeah, thank you.
Councillor Martin?
Thank you. Well, I think this concept of community gardens is a good concept. The problem I'm having with this, and I'm going to support it, I cannot see a community garden in Michaud Park or Douglas Park. If I look at the community garden we have now on the floodplain, it's an 8 or 10 foot chain link fence around it. I would assume we'd have to do the same there. And if you look at both of those parks that I mentioned, do you want a 10-foot chain link fence in the middle of the park or wherever? And, you know, I mean, Michaud Park, we've got that wonderful, fairly new play area there. It's not a big park to start with. A lot of people use that park to walk around and what have you. So I just can't see it there. Douglas Park, I mean, you know all the things that we do in Douglas Park. Again, I can't see a 10-foot squared off area there. So are you going to look at other areas besides these areas?
Well, I think right now they're going to look at this and then come back after the consultation. And then as a council, we can look at something further.
So at this point, it says consider the following parks. That doesn't mean to say it's going to happen. I could not support at least those two parks. I certainly support the community gardens, but not in those two parks.
I think with this motion, there's going to be a consultation. We're going to look at these parks, bring it back, and then council can decide on that. And if there's another motion down the road to look at another area, that's up to the committee. I think it's a great idea. I commend the committee for bringing this forward. I know the last park, community garden, I should say, took a lot of time and effort. It took 3 years to get it up and going, because I know Mrs. Jean Schaefer worked very hard on that, and I know who came along and helped her on that. Two of the plots were for the school children at Nicomackle School, so the school kids were growing, and they were taught about vegetables, And in the summertime, somebody had to look after that, and I know who looked after that. So there is a huge commitment there. So you just don't throw it together. So I'm glad there's a consultation program coming forward. So again, so I'll call the question on the motion. All those in favor? It's unanimous 4. Let's see now. The next one is Recreation, Culture, and Public Art Advisory Committee, Pump House Mural. That council consider the approval of the mural proposal submitted by Magical Murals for installation at Douglas Park Pump House. The cost of the mural is to total $1,850 and is to be completed in time for the Langley Seniors Games. I need a motion for this. Councillor Wallace, seconded by Martin. Discussion? Councillor Wallace, would you like to speak to it?
You've received it in your packages. Just for the audience's benefit, we need to replace the mural on the pump house at Douglas Water Park. So we had two submissions, and it was presented to the RCPAC committee, and we tweaked on some things that we wanted to be sent back, and they quickly got back to us. And I'm here to take any questions from council and suggestions. Are there any questions?
Councillor Hall?
So I'm looking at it, but the viewing audience, is there not a projection of it?
To staff?
There's not, but...
Can they go to our website and see, or do they have to wait for the unveiling?
Tomorrow we'll have it on the website. As soon as council has approved it, we will have it up on the website.
Okay, I'm good.
Discussion? All those in favor? Against? Unanimous 4. Administrative reports. Liquor license application. LL02-14, Rising Tide Consultants for the Brown Social House. And this is again similar to the others, so they could get their signage and then we have a discussion. The motion is that the adjacent residents and property owners be notified of the liquor license application by Rising Tide Consultants for a change to the hours of operation at Brown Social House, located at Unit 101-20065 Langley Bypass, that the applicant be required to erect a public notice sign on the subject property, and that a public hearing be held on September 15, 2014 to gather the views of residents and property owners. I need a motion by Councillor James. Councillor Wallace, or Martin seconded. Discussion? Councillor Hall?
Mayor, to staff, could, for the benefit of the public, could you suggest the change in the hours of operation from what was originally proposed and what's proposed now, if there are some? Or was this the original proposal?
This was the to staff.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This was the original intent of the owners of Brown Social House. However, the initial liquor license they received from the province is the default liquor license, which is enables them to serve liquor up until 12 midnight. If they wish to go beyond that closing time for serving of liquor, they need to get local government approval for that under the liquor license regulation, which is what they are now applying for.
Supplementary?
Councillor Hall?
So jog my memory, we just went through one of these for another establishment up the road, and does the closing time here match that approved application? That went through the public hearing, did it, and we've moved along and approved it?
I think the reference, Mr. Mayor, is to the Cactus Club Cafe application that council recently considered. And there the proposal was to extend the hours of closing beyond midnight again, as here, However, there's some slight differences in the closing times at that establishment, whereas in this application, the closing times would be 1 a.m. for all 7 days in the week. In that application, I believe Monday to Friday were 1 a.m. and the other days 1:30 a.m. except Sunday, which was midnight. So there's a little difference in the closing times, but again, it was an application to extend the hours of service.
Further discussion? Councillor Arnold.
Wasn't the one we just did for Match at the casino? Wasn't that the most recent one?
That's also a recent one. There were a number
and
of...
What are their hours?
I don't have that figure here. I believe it was 2 a.m. in that case, though. And there were a number of other changes to the liquor license there beyond just the hours of servicers, capacity, and some other things.
Further discussion? All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. The next item is the neighborhood profiles. I need a motion that the 2014 neighborhood profiles be received for information. Councillor James, Councillor Martin, discussion. Councillor Martin.
Thank you. Can I assume that these have already been printed?
No, they've not been printed yet.
That's good. Page 195, the Nicomeckel area. You've got the Douglas Park area highlighted for the Nicomeckel area. If you look at the one before, which is Douglas Park, it's highlighted, and it's highlighted again under Nicomeckel.
Well, to the viewing audience out there, please take a look on our website, which is going to be out there in the next couple days. Discover Your Neighborhood is very interesting to see what is in your neighborhood. Your staff have done a lot of research and a lot of work putting this together. So there are 6 neighborhoods. I'd like to commend staff on the work that they've done. It's a lot of hard work. And it's a job well done. Further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. Tim's Community Center Renewal Project Award of Contract. Motion is that City Council authorize the Chief Administrative Officer and the Corporate Officer to execute the design build stipulate price contract for the construction of the Tim's Community Center Renewal Project between the City of Langley and DGS Construction and Hughes Condon Marler Architects based on the total fixed contract price of $12,860,000, including all fees, cash allowances, contingencies, and taxes, and excluding GST as outlined in the request for proposal and addenda plus additional design enhancements. I need that motion to be put on the table. Councillor Hall, seconded by Councillor Martin. Discussion. To staff, the timeline?
Your Worship, we were planning on breaking ground hopefully by the end of August or early September. We're working through some issues with BC Hydro to locate some of their utilities to allow us to actually excavate the site. But we're moving very quickly in a very aggressive pace. And again, the timeline to complete the project still remains December 2015.
So 2015, that's what we're shooting for. So thank you, Mr. Chung. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. Next item is July 2014 community grant. The City Council endorsed the recommendation of the Community Grant Committee to award community grant totaling $800 to the following organization, the Langley Association for Community Living, and that is for $800. I need that motion.
Motion.
Motion by Councillor James, seconded by Councillor Wallace. Discussion? All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. New and unfinished business. I have a motion from Councillor Hall, consultation with School District 35. Councillor Hall.
I'm just thinking I got to change a little bit of the wording here, because if it's not really timely, then it's not going to even work, because it refers to the acting mayor. So if they wait too long, it would become the mayor. So I'm just going to insert that in there, that the city of Langley and its acting mayor slash or mayor and council seek timely and genuine consultation and discussion with the trustees and staff of School District Number 35 Langley regarding future facilities, planning and implementation, busing, and expenditures.
Seconder. I need a seconder for that motion. Councillor Wallace. And further clarification, discussion now?
It.
Yes, go ahead.
Speaking to it, well, the school district has announced that they are going to have a consultation with a variety of groups on their facilities plan and a number of other issues. We have not met as a formal group for well over a year. They've suggested that they're going to spend large amounts of money, perhaps, in upgrading the seismic state of LSS to the tune of $35 million. But in addition to that, they've announced that they're contemplating on the Willoughby Hill busing the overload of students as far away as Poppy or Aldergrove. And I think that the city should be having discussions with those trustees and the superintendent and the secretary treasurer about what possibilities there are for enhancing opportunities within the city and perhaps a reconfiguration of some existing facilities. So we need to have that discussion. The last time they told us they consulted with us, it was just an information session about site acquisition. So this motion is simply to offer the olive branch at this point, but actually try to get some genuine consultation going between these two bodies. Thank you.
Discussion? Councillor James.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So as you're aware, you and I sit on the School District 35 liaison committee as the representatives for this council. So I'm going to respectfully suggest, I'm not going to support this, because I'm going to respectfully suggest that you and I ask our corporate clerk to add this to our agenda, because that's the purpose of this committee that we sit on. I believe we meet again in September, and I would have absolutely no problem. I would like it a little more streamlined. This is like very vast and very vague, but it's always nice when we can add items to the agenda when we have discussions, and I think that that would be more appropriate than all of us meeting all of us, because that's when it tends to get more into an info session versus a roll-up-your-sleeves working session like we experience when we sit at the table. Thank you.
Councillor Wallace.
As a seconder to that motion, I'm in favor of taking it back to the committee in hopes that both you and Councillor James will bring back the information to us. I mean, because we are all entitled to see with every committee the agenda and the minutes. And so hopefully, yeah, the sooner the better. And if that meeting is going to happen, then I'm in favor of, as a seconder, and just want to thank Councillor Hall for bringing it up forward. Thank you.
Councillor Hall?
Well, I have no objection to you sending that back to committee, but I guess the question I would ask is, this liaison committee, what was resolved on school site acquisition and what consultation happened there? The school district's facilities plan has been out there for months, and I haven't heard anything that was discussed on that in those months. So my greatest fear is, once again, we'll be left behind the door. So I would suggest that you endorse this particular motion and we all get together.
Further discussion, Councillor James.
Thank you again, Mr. Mayor. Well, Councillor Hall, I know you're aware that the school site acquisition actually wasn't something that was discussed at this committee level because it was an entire council decision and consultation process. So, and as far as the seismic upgrading, what I can tell you is that a discussion has been had at this committee level. It's still in camera because of the, to be perfectly honest with you, because of the state of the unrest of everything else. But I can assure you that if this is put on the agenda, there is literally city representatives and school board 35 represents sitting around that table. So again, I would like to see something a little more streamlined. This is pretty vast, like going in and saying, we want to talk about future facilities, planning, implementation, busing, expenditures, just actually have like a genuine list of tasks and real questions that you would like to see asked. But again, as one of the two council members who sit on that committee and one of four city representatives, I honestly think that this committee will get an audience sooner than us in as a council in its entirety. Thank you.
Councillor Wallace.
I just have a question to staff in regards to whenever there is a committee meeting, I know that we are appointed as co-chair and chair or representing the city in those meetings. At any time, is any councillor able to take part in a meeting that another council might be represented on?
To staff.
Your Worship, it's up to the chair to invite whichever councillor who might wish to attend. I don't believe there's anything written that restrict council members who wants to attend to the liaison committee.
So to follow up on that, if Councillor Hall, I feel, is wanting to do that, he there's a lot of things to address. There's only a certain amount of time in those meetings, as I was the liaison before Councillor James. But I'm just thinking there is a lot to address here, and the school board has their meetings as well that we are able to attend. And I think at any time, if we have an interest in a certain topic of the many that you have listed, that we can at any time have an appointment with a trustee or the superintendent for that matter. So I just wanted to put that out there. So thank you.
I think it's excellent to have some discussion on future facilities, because I'm not sure what the school district has got planned for LSS. And the LSS is accepting Langley City students now there, so it would be very interesting to see what is being planned for that facility. There's many rumors going out about millions of dollars for earthquaking, building, moving, so it would be a great discussion. And is there any further discussion on this particular motion? Okay, all those in favor of this motion? Against this motion? Councillor Hall is in favor of this motion. Everybody else is against this motion. Is there another motion to Councillor James?
I'd like to move that, or notice a motion, or motion, I'm not sure of the process, sorry, that Councillor Hall's questions be streamlined into direct questions, and that Mayor Schaefer and myself, as the appointed representatives for the school district committee, ask these very same questions, or ask to have them on the agenda so they can be addressed at the next meeting. And Trustee McFarlane is the chair of that committee, so I don't think there's any harm in asking the question. But what I don't want to see happen is everybody weighing in and having an opinion and getting excited and stuff like that. I think these questions need to be on the agenda and asked by the representatives on this committee. Thank you.
Councillor, seconded by Councillor Arnold. So I have a question to the mover and seconder. I have no problem taking this question that he has, that my colleague has, in its entirety, because you have regarding future facilities, you have planning, you have implementation, you have busing, and the expenditures. Are you fine with this paragraph? Okay, thank you. Discussion on the motion? I'll read out the motion that the City of Langley and its acting mayor and or mayor and council, pardon me, seek timely and genuine consultation and discussion with the trustees, so which would be at the staff level, or pardon me, at the committee level. So that is the school liaison committee, that is correct? Is that the proper name for it?
Basically the same intent, but what I actually have is that the concerns in Councillor Hall's motion be streamlined into direct questions, and that the liaison members ask that they be added to the next school liaison meeting agenda.
School liaison committee. Okay. Discussion? Councillor Hall.
Well, I guess I got to ask the question, who's going to streamline what I've already presented? So someone else is translating my work? So the two people on the committee, I'm expecting then, will streamline and present those questions? And the second item I would ask, we've never had a direct report from that committee, so when would I expect the report back? At the next meeting following that liaison meeting?
Right.
Fine.
That's why, to my colleague, that's why I asked the question that this be the question asked. You know, there is no no variances. This is the question. What are you going to do with future regarding future facilities? What are your planning? What's your implementation, busing and or expenditures? And there's no streamlining there. And whoever happens to be at that meeting, we'll bring it back to the next council meeting. Is further discussion?
Point of order, Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
What you're saying and what we're voting on are two different things, though. The motion says to streamline, correct?
I asked for clarification from the mover and the seconder.
The mover said streamline, I believe.
You know, streamline again, whatever the word needs to be. I think the question, this can't be one question. It has to be on the agenda, and it has to say, we would like to know the question or the answers regarding your specific plans for future facilities,
right.
Planning and implementation, I guess, of the future facilities,
right.
If there is any at all, busing of all of our kids, none of our kids, elementary kids, high school kids, like
This is the question you're posing. That's why I asked.
And then expenditures associated with what? Busing, future facilities, planning and implementation, all of the above. That's my challenge. This is not streamlined enough.
That's why I asked the mover and the seconder if this was what they wanted to bring forward. And Councillor Wallace.
Okay. The reason why I'm thinking, reading your mind, maybe Councillor Hall, is that we don't want to go down the wrong road again as far as planning for the future. As far as if we go back in time when it came to decide to close a high school and shuffle everybody over to LSS and the Willoughby Slope, as we know, is that they're not caught up with their development as far as kids moving into that area. So now they want to bus kids all the way out to WD Poppy and Aldergrove when the bus ride would probably be shorter from Willoughby down to here. I think in Councillor Hall's, I think all of the questions that Councillor Hall wants to present are all relevant questions, but I think what we should do first is maybe talk about facilities. And in talking about just the planning of facilities, it's just an automatic that busing will have to be discussed and a lot of the other issues that you have presented. So. I think there's a number of issues that take part on that committee as far as, you know, education, recreation within the city. It's just that if we made that I think it would just take up too much time, but I think we need an answer of what does the facilities look like in the very near future and then go from that. Thank you.
Further discussions on that motion? I'll call the question on the motion then. All those in favor of this motion going to the school liaison committee, all those in favor? Yes. Against? This. Interesting conversations. Okay, Councillor Hall, you have another one here?
I'm wondering how I can streamline this. That the acting mayor and council of the city of Langley direct staff to prepare a report that surveys the staffing levels of community, recreation, and culture facilities that are of roughly a comparable size, approximately 30,000 square feet, to the proposed TIMS Community Center with reference to programming and supervision needs, maintenance, and security.
Okay, there's a motion. I need a seconder. Seconder, Councillor Wallace.
Speaking to that, we originally planned the TIMS Community Center as a replacement for the old one. The old one was, well, let's say, roughly half of the size of the present one that we envisioned. The thinking all along has been that staffing levels would be basically the same and we'd simply move staff over, but as this project got bigger and bigger and bigger, even the design features started to question whether the staffing levels would be adequate to support the proposed new facility. Now, this doesn't have to be an immediate report, but certainly as we move towards an opening date of December 2015, surely in the next round of budget discussions, we should have before us some vision of what the staffing levels might be. I acknowledge that there will be economies of scale, and because we're tying it to the present building, we might be able to have eyes on the facility that are from both sides. But certainly there are operations out there, community centers, that we could have the staff phone and do a bit of a phone survey and just say, well, how many people operate within the building that you have? What are your hours of operation? We don't presently have Sunday opening. Holy smokes, maybe this new facility would be looking at that. Perhaps that would mean that we would add, well, we have limited Sunday openings. It's not a full-scale, full-meal deal, okay? Perhaps the hours of operation might be longer. Perhaps the number of programs we might envision to grow to the size of facility that we've created. I just don't like operating in a vacuum of information prior to budget deliberations that surely will be coming our way this coming year. I wouldn't want us all of a sudden increasing by a whole bunch of other staff when we know that maybe there's hundreds of thousands of dollars of extra money that's going to be spent at the TIMS Center and we've locked ourselves in other areas. We need that information in a timely way early. And that means starting soon.
Mr. Chung, I have a question for you. Did staff already do a preliminary report on this?
Your Worship, we're already looking into that. We had to look at that when we started planning out for the size of the facility, the number of rooms, the size of the rooms, the equipment that we need to purchase to accommodate the needs and the programs that we envision. So we are already working on that. Ms. Hilton is leading the charge on that. And we will be bringing a report to council during the budget deliberation process to consider all that. So naturally, we're doing that right now.
Okay. So did you have a... Councillor Martin?
Thank you. Well, thank you to Mr. Chung. I'm not going to support this. The reason I'm not going to support it, because our staff, our very competent staff, I'm sure, know that we're not going to move into a 35,000 square foot community center, which is more than double or triple the size that we have now, and think that they can operate with the same staff. I mean, anybody in their right mind knows that we can't do that. And I'm sure that our staff are going to come to us in plenty of time saying what they need. I can remember years and years ago, I believe when Ms. Hilton was hired, we had six recreation programs, six. I don't know how many we have now, well over 100. We didn't need staff to, we didn't need to motion to say, well, okay, if you're going to go from 6 to 12 or 12 to 18 or whatever, we need a report on how much this is going to cost. Staff automatically does that. I don't think we give our staff enough credit sometimes. They know what they have to do to prepare themselves for this new community center. And I think we all know that come December 2015, it's going to cost a lot more to operate the Tim's Community Center than it does now. We didn't even have a Tim's Community Center when Ms. Hilton was hired. We had Douglas Recreation Center and six little programs. So I will not be supporting this. I think our staff are competent enough to know what kind of information we're going to need to make the decisions we need to make when it comes to budget time. Thanks.
Councillor Wallace.
In seconding the motion, which we should do to get further information, is why I seconded the motion. And Mr. Chung answered the questions, and Councillor Hall is putting forth a motion, but it doesn't mean that we can't have the, you know, I think in all fairness, it's now the public knows from what Mr. Chung said, and I don't think it's a matter of Councillor Hall not having faith in our staff. It's just, just thank you.
Further discussion? I know for myself, I will be voting in favor of this because I know staff has been working on this to get to a certain point on the Tim's Community Center. So what this does is just bring it forward so we can deal with it at our budget time. So I'll call the question. All those in favor of the motion? Against? Hall and Schaefer were for. The others were against. Correspondence. Request for permission to conduct door-to-door canvassing on behalf of World Vision, Red Cross, and BC Children's Hospital. And the motion is that Council permit TNI Network to conduct door-to-door canvassing for World Vision, Red Cross, and BC Children's Hospital during the months of August, October, and December. So that is, I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Wallace, seconded by Councillor Martin. Discussion, James, and then Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It's not so much a discussion, just clarification. I'm sure I read in the body of this letter somewhere that this organization does not accept money at the door. So if they come to your door, they're not going to be asking for any cash of any kind. It's all set up through sponsorships and sponsoring children and stuff like that. So you can expect paperwork, but not handing over any cash. So if I'm correct, I just wanted to make the community aware of that. That's what makes these guys legit. So thank you.
Councillor Hall.
We had this discussion last year, and I'm having great difficulty with this application in that they don't specify dates. They provide 3 months window of opportunity, but they don't actually say when they're going to be there. And then there's a statement in here that suggests that, well, they won't be full months. We'll do partials. So I think we had the discussion about a year ago that suggested that we would require some specific dates and a total number of days so that the public would not potentially be badgered for, in this case, if they went three full months, it would be 90 full days. There's a lot of people asking for a variety of very worthwhile charities, and I think this is one of them. But I think we'd asked in the past for some specific dates and a window of opportunity. So if we could have clarification on that, I might have more comfort.
To Mr. Chung.
Your Worship, the last time they seek approval from Council for door-to-door canvassing, it was from January 28th to March 1st, 2013, and from June 1st to July 1st, 2013, and November 1st to December 1st, 2013. I think in this application, I think they mentioned the month of August, October, and December. That they will not be canvassing the entire month, but they want to do the canvassing within those 3 months.
And a clarification to staff.
And council can dictate, specify the timeline if you so choose.
The clarification to staff, was there dates in there? I thought the last motion or the policy going back said that there was only 10 days at any given time. That was the council direction back then?
Yours, I think this organization is representing three organizations. That's why we gave them a time block for each organization instead of just one 10 days for.
So it would be a 10-day period for one, a 10-day period for another, and a 10-day period for the other? I mean, we could get further clarification. And we would skip August.
Yeah, the next meeting is September. What we can, council can decide is to do something similar than last time. I don't see any 10 days referencing the policy.
No, as I'd hate to see three months of canvassing going on. So any further discussion, Councillor Hall?
Okay, well, I'll suggest that in that they suggest that they won't do entire months. Perhaps we could suggest to them that they have a 3 2-week window of opportunities. So it's three organizations, 2 weeks for one in one of the months that they suggest, okay, and then two, and then two. Okay, if that doesn't work for them, the August one, at least they have the opportunity to go and do. In September, if they wish to have some modification of that, they can come back to us.
Is that okay with the staff there?
Yeah, so I would suggest then that Councillor Hall is making an amendment to permit the TNI network to conduct door-to-door canvassing for World Vision, Red Cross, BC Children's Hospital for a 2-week period in each month of August, October, and December.
So that's the amendment then from Councillor Hall, seconded by Councillor Martin. Further discussion? All those in favor? So the motion is now. And now for the motion itself. I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor, well, did we do the yeah, okay, vote on it then. All those in favor? It's unanimous for. And last one is just some information for support of provincial funding to develop and maintain services for sexually exploited children and youth. And the next one is New Westminster and District Labor Council, September 1st to 7th, Union Label Buying Week. And is there any new business? Councillor James and Martin?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to make the community aware that downtown Langley will be celebrating its 21st annual Arts Alive Festival on Saturday, August the 16th. And it's just an incredible festival with over 240 artists, artisans, performers, street performers, kids venue, you name it, it's incorporated now. Musical performances all day. The best part is it's 100% free to attend. Absolutely nothing other than purchasing something from a vendor itself costs any yourself or any member of your family a penny. So please come out. It happens rain or shine, but it's not going to rain. So that's Saturday, August 16th from 10 to 5. Thank you.
Councillor Martin.
Thank you very much. I just want to inform the public that the Gateway of Hope, the Salvation Army Gateway of Hope, is having a very large fundraiser this weekend. It's the ride into history. But the main thing that the public can enjoy is a concert on Friday night in Fort Langley at the fort at 7 o'clock. Its entrance is by donation, and Randy Elvis Frisky will be there. I think it's going to be a lot of fun, but it's one way that you can support the Gateway of Hope. And, of course, on Saturday, they have all the motorcycle riders taking a ride into history and go through the valley. and then it winds up Sunday morning, and it's all taking place in Fort Langley. But do come out on Friday night at 7 o'clock. They are going to have some food vendors at the fort, or you can enjoy a nice restaurant in Fort Langley, and hope to see you there. Admission by donation. Thanks a lot.
Anything else? Need a motion to adjourn. Councillors Arnold, Councillor James, all those in favor? It's unanimous 4. Thank you. Good evening. See you. See you in September.
We'll see you in the last again, Rob. Maybe.